Welcome back, everyone. This is the second video for Chapter 4 on Igneous Rocks. Previously, we introduced felsic and mafic magma compositions. The other two magma compositions we need to talk about now are intermediate and ultramafic. Let's start with our intermediate composition, also known as andesitic. The intermediate composition magmas are getting a greater amount of ferromagnesium minerals, and they're associated with volcanic activity on the seaward margin of continents and volcanic island arcs. Andesites are known to be present in large amounts in the Andes Mountains. Our last magma composition is ultramafic, and ultramafic is composed entirely of ferromagnesium minerals and primarily olivine with a little bit of pyroxene. The igneous rock called a peridotite, which we introduced in Chapter 2 on plate tectonics, makes up the upper mantle and is an example of an ultramafic composition igneous rock. These are the highest temperature, lowest silica content igneous rock. Silica content varies in our igneous rocks. Ultramafic rocks can have as little as 40% silica content, whereas felsic rocks can contain greater than 70% silica. The importance of silica is its influence on magma behavior. The felsic or granitic magmas with high silica contents, 70% or greater, means that the magma is very viscous. Viscous is a term used to describe the resistance to flow of a magma or lava. Basaltic magmas, on the other hand, or mafic magmas, have much lower silica content in the range of 50%. They are non-viscous compared to granitic magmas and behave more like a fluid. They are also higher temperature magmas compared to the granitic magmas. Granitic or felsic magmas, once again, have high silica content and are viscous compared to basaltic magmas with lower silica content and non-viscous behavior. So silica affects the viscosity of a magma. I want to introduce the term texture and then introduce several textures associated with igneous rocks. First of all, by definition, a texture is the overall appearance of a rock based on the size, shape, and arrangement of the minerals present. It is not the feel of the rock, as we generally think of when we think of the term texture. Some of the factors that influence igneous texture include: how fast does it cool? Magma cooling within the earth cools slower compared to magma extruded out onto the earth's surface. When magma cools slowly, you get fewer minerals or crystals, but they are large. Whereas a fast rate of cooling, that would be at the earth's surface or very near the earth's surface, you get smaller crystals, but more of them. Another factor influencing the texture is how much silica is involved and the amount of dissolved gases. Here are a variety of textures. Let's just start out with glassy. A glassy texture forms in an igneous rock that is cooled very rapidly, so rapidly that the silicon and the oxygen atoms don't even join together, so it's glass. A vesicular texture is a texture with holes in it due to gases escaping. Pumice is an example. A phaneritic texture is a texture that forms deep in the earth as the magma cools very slowly. Fanner is a term that means visible. So the minerals in a phaneritic igneous rock are visible to the unaided eye. On the other hand, rapid cooling near or at the Earth's surface produces a very fine-grained texture we call aphanitic. The prefix A in the word aphanitic means not. Fan, again, is visible. So the mineral crystals are not visible without a microscope in an aphanitic textured igneous rock. So we've got a couple other textures. Pyroclastic, pyro, that means fire. And clast are pieces. These are pieces of rock that get violently blown out of a volcano. These are the most dangerous types of volcanic eruptions, those with pyroclastic materials. Once the pyroclastic materials, such as ash and lapilli, land on the Earth, they can be glued together in what we call a welded tuff. We'll talk about more here. And then our last texture we can talk about is a porphyritic texture. That's an in-between texture. So you have large crystals. While the magma was cooling slowly, we call those phenocrysts. And then there is a fine grain matrix or ground mass after the magma has moved up closer to the Earth's surface or out onto the surface. It cools very rapidly, so the mineral crystals are too small to be seen with the eye. So we have two different size crystals, two distinct sizes for a porphyritic texture. One other texture not listed here is called a pegmatitic texture. And by definition, a pegmatitic texture are minerals that are greater than 1 centimeter in size for the rock. And this only forms when there are fluid-rich environments in the last stage of crystallization. Most of the time, pegmatites are granitic in composition. Reviewing, aphanitic, not visible, fine grain, rapid cooling at the Earth's surface. Phaneritic, phaner being visible, is coarse grain, indicating slow cooling with large visible crystals. You do not need to magnify them with a microscope. Porphyritic texture, an in-between texture where you get large crystals called phenocrysts, embedded in a matrix of smaller crystals, we'll call the ground mass. Here's a very nice example of an igneous rock with a porphyritic texture. Continuing on, our vesicular texture. There are vesicles or holes in the rock due to the gases trying to escape. Very common for extrusive igneous rocks. Keep in mind the gas content in magma is between 1 to 6%. Glass indicates very rapid cooling. Pyroclastic, consolidation of individual rock fragments that are violently ejected during an eruption. And our pegmatites are exceptionally coarse-grained, greater than 1 centimeter in size for the minerals, and indicating late stages of crystallization of magma involving a lot of fluids as well. Here's a picture of a vesicular basalt or scoria. This is simply a basalt that where the gas has tried to escape and the vesicles formed around it. This is an example of basalt, but they're very different in appearance. This basalt here is called a'a, Hawaiian name. And it means jagged and sharp edges, because when you walk over an a'a flow, you are going to go ah. Up here is another basaltic flow. Notice the difference in texture compared to the a'a. This is pohoihoi, and it is a more ropey appearance. So why two different basalt flows? It has to do with cooling. The texture changes as the rock cools and degasses. This is a Native American arrowhead that is made out of volcanic glass and exhibits a glassy texture. This is a picture of an eruption column for a pyroclastic eruption. This is a lot of ash and debris, and as it goes up into the air, eventually it will collapse on itself, come rushing down the side of the volcano, and incinerate anything in its path. Once again, the pyroclastic eruptions are the most dangerous. So rocks that develop are called pyroclastic rocks. That's the texture for this igneous rock. Well, this concludes our second video for Chapter 4 on igneous rocks. Have a good day.